Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. Last week, I had the distinct pleasure of speaking to a Sheva Brachas gathering. This is part of the post-wedding festivities that are common in observant Jewish communities. I was invited to speak on a historical topic by Mr. Saul Friedman, a friend of mine who is a very enthusiastic student of Jewish history. And although it was unusual, as he is somewhat nonconformist in many of his ways, I accepted the offer and I actually had a really good time. This is an abbreviated version of that talk, which was specifically designed to give a very broad and rapid overview of the historical experience of Hungarian Jewry. The Friedmans, like many Hungarian Jewish families, have demonstrated a remarkable resilience in the post-Holocaust era. They have demonstrated phenomenal attachment, ferocious attachment to Jewish tradition, especially in Brooklyn, as we shall see. And so I wanted to give the young couple a sense of where they come from historically within the space of a very brief amount of time, and especially as everyone waited for dessert. So let's have a very quick look at the experience of the Jews of Hungary. When did the Jews first come to Hungary? Well, apparently the earliest archaeological remnants we have of Hungarian Jews stem from the Roman Jewish community. As you can see in this map, a large number of Jews made their way to the Italian peninsula, in particular to the city of Rome, already before the Common Era. There are references, for example, in the year 59 to Jewish communities being active there and so on, and some of the great Roman writers refer to Jews, but by the time you get to the first century, there is a massive influx of Jews after the disastrous Roman-Jewish War, in which perhaps tens or even over 100,000 Jews were taken in slave ships to work in the Roman-Jewish capital. And then we begin to see Jews making their way into Roman society in a very positive way. Actually, many of them, of course, retained citizenship from before the war era. And by the time you get to the second century, we already see Jews moving with Roman soldiers, as Roman soldiers, apparently, to Hungary. So if you have a look at this unusual example, which dates from roughly the year 200, it's some kind of strange memorial stone. I hesitate to call it a gravestone because it seems that the figures displayed there are all alive, or at least the purchaser of the stone is alive, and it describes a soldier named Germanius Valens with his wife Bracha, clearly a very Jewish name. He's also portrayed with his mother-in-law, another strong indication that he's probably Jewish, and their 4 and 2-year-old daughters. The middle register of this particular stone also demonstrates a sacrificial scene. But although it's hard to parse out exactly what this stone means, it is an indication, along with several other pieces that are roughly of the same era, that there were Jews already making their way into Hungary with Romans. By the time we get to the end of the first millennium, we know that there are significant numbers of Jews already in the 11th century. Several records of settlements have been preserved, and the Jews had some significantly economic successes. As we see, the same kind of pattern happening elsewhere in the European continent, Jews are sometimes caught between the nobility and the kings, primarily because of their economic productivity and the designs on the profits that can be gained by taxing them. And in general, they are protected by the kings. There is a significant downturn in the Jewish community in Hungarian lands in the 14th century after the Black Death, when there is a rash of anti-Jewish persecution, as Jews were thought to somehow be responsible for the plague, and also the related blood libels. There was one not too far from Hungary in Tirnau in 1494 that resulted in 16 Jews horribly being burned at the stake. Pogroms followed, debts to Jews were canceled, and the Jewish community suffered a significant downturn in the 15th century. But speaking of Tirnau, one of the most interesting kind of legends that relate to the Jews of Hungary is something that's associated with Rabbi Yitzhak Isaac of Tirnau, who wrote an important Sefer HaMinhagim, a book of customs that gives us some sense as to the actual practices of East Central European Jewry at this time. According to the legend, the Hungarian crown prince fell in love with his beautiful daughter, who was known for her intelligence and for her wisdom and things like that. And so he actually gave up the throne and traveled to study with some Sephardic rabbis in order to convert to Judaism, and ultimately he came back and he married her. He lived under an assumed new Jewish identity until ultimately his identity was betrayed and the church demanded that he recant. According to the legend, of which we don't have a lot of other sources, he refused and he was burnt at the stake for his love. Fascinating kind of story. At any rate, by the time we get to the 16th century, Hungary comes under the Ottoman Turks. That is the Muslim forces that swept over much of the region and began to penetrate into East Central lands. At that time, Sephardim were actually attracted to the region of Hungary, particularly in the city of Buda, because this is the era when the Spanish Inquisition had begun, and the expulsion, of course, of 1492 sent a lot of Jews literally adrift in the Mediterranean Sea, and the Ottoman Turks actually welcomed them, laughing at the Spanish king and queen, Ferdinand and Isabella, for releasing such valuable human resources into the orbit of Constantinople. So there are a lot of Jews that come from the highly educated Spanish and Portuguese lands to Hungary at this point. One of the most important leaders of the 17th century is Rabbi Ephraim Kohen, who wrote the Shaar Ephraim, a very influential work. Ultimately, the Ottomans are driven back, and the Habsburgs who come in are subject to some anti-Semitic pressures, but nevertheless, Jews are, as we saw in the High Middle Ages, largely protected, granted autonomy, and they have a relatively secure lifestyle by the time you get to the 17th century, protected by kings. When we move to the 19th century, we see an era of tremendous change. And have a look at this graph here, which shows you the tremendous population explosion of Jews in Hungary from 11,600 in 1735 to almost a million in 1910. And there are several reasons for this. One reason is in-migration, and I'll have a closer look at that in just a second. Second is natural growth. And third, very relevant to our own times with COVID-19, is the smallpox vaccine is circulating, and that contributes significantly to a reduction in infant mortality, which is especially important for Jews in urban environments and their relatively early adoption of vaccination as a way to protect themselves against disease. There is, however, a growing divide between the urban and the rural cultures of the Jews, the former tending to be much more modernizing in nature and the latter being much more traditionalist. I'm going to see that very clearly in a second. Nevertheless, in the 19th century, particularly in the city that would come to be known as Budapest, that is both sides of the Danube River, there would be a remarkable explosion of Jews into the professions as they begin to gain incremental rights in education and in political and social movement. Have a look at this chart here, which shows you the percentage of Jews in several professions in the beginning of the 20th century. You can see that they're, of course, very strong in commerce, about 60% of merchants were Jews, but also in the professions, 42% of journalists, 45% of lawyers, 49% of doctors. Very significant penetration given the much smaller percentage of Jews in the larger population. However, not that far out from their percentage in the urban population, especially in large cities like Budapest. The traditionalists, on the other hand, were championed in particular by Rabbi Moshe Schreiber, nor more popularly by his nom de plume, the Chassam Sofer, who lived just a little bit upriver. He was especially associated with the city of Pressburg, now known as Bratislava. The Chassam Sofer was arguably the most prominent defender of the traditionalist viewpoint, and at one point he famously made a pun on a passage which in its original context refers to the consumption of the new harvest of wheat, but he said it with a rather different intonation. The phrase, of course, in Hebrew is chadash asur min haTorah. The new wheat is forbidden by the Torah, but the word wheat is omitted in the original. So in other words, he was saying the new is forbidden by the Torah, meaning anything new is ipso facto forbidden by the Torah. Now that's, of course, an exaggeration. In many ways, the Chassam Sofer was, for example, very pro-science. I mentioned earlier the vaccinations, things like that. But he was nevertheless very much against any innovations which would threaten the traditional fabric of observant Jewish society. And now, it's important to note that when we think about the populations in Hungary, there are very, very distinct and remarkable differences between them. So if you look at this map here of Hungary, that comes from the Encyclopedia Judaica, you can see that there's a major center in Budapest where you have the Magyar Jews, that is, those Jews who believe that the best way for Jews to accommodate modernity is to essentially align themselves with the Hungarian nation. That is, remember that this is a highly multi-ethnic region with German-speaking Austrians and with Romanians, Poles, Ukrainians, you know, and all kinds of other peoples living here. The Hungarian nationality, known as the Magyars, were concentrated in Budapest, and there were a lot of Jews there who felt that that was the best way for them to move forward, was by to identify with the Magyars in particular. The second major thing to think about is in-migration from two other lands. The Danube River is certainly the most important waterway that cuts through the country of Hungary, and you can see that sort of swoops down from the upper left and then makes a dramatic turn to the south through Budapest. So you have a number of Jews who are coming from the region which on this map is Czechoslovakia, but back then it would have been Austria and Germany. And you have another group of Jews coming from the northeast, which would be in particular Poland. Here on this map it says Poland and the USSR, but during the period discussed, it would have been the Russian Empire. And there is a region in the middle which was actually closed to Jewish settlement before 1840. That's roughly shown by this gray circle here. So you have two very, very different communities that have to be considered in the top part of Hungary. First of all, you have the Oberlanders, the uplanders, that is because they are coming upriver along the Danube. And these are Jews who are largely under the sway of the Chassam Sofer, and also a little bit further away, Rabbi Samson Raphael Hirsch, who would be representative more of the Neo-Orthodox movement. That is, these are Jews who consider themselves more within the Germanic orbit of thought. They are German speakers, by and large, and they are more open to some degrees to Westernization, but clearly within a traditional Lithuanian Talmudic in a sort of way of thinking. But on the other side, on the east, you have the Unterlanders. Here you have a tremendous number of Polish Hasidim moving into northeastern Hungary. They are primarily Yiddish speakers, far more traditionalist in their orientation, and that creates a very, very different kind of population. So we have three distinct populations. Now, if you think about the relative numbers, have a look at this map, which shows you the relative density of the Jewish population. You can see that circled in the middle there is a high density of population in the city of Budapest itself, but a much thinner number of Jews of the Oberlanders, that is the more Germanic-speaking Jews in the northwest, and then that massive block of Hasidic Jewry, incidentally the heartland of modern Hungarian Hasidim in America as well, including the Friedman family and their descendants. They are off in the northeast, as you can see there. And that's really where we have the bulk of the population and the geographic center of gravity for Hungarian Jewry. The interwar period showed many signs, like many other countries in East Central Europe, of impending doom for the Jews of Hungary. There's a lot of legislative anti-Semitism that begins, such as a numerous clauses that is applied to universities in 1920, that is severely restricting the number of Jewish students who are allowed to be present in classes. A number of discriminatory pieces of legislation, such as the first Jewish law of 1938, draw boundaries around where Hungarian Jews are allowed to participate in larger society. And of course, during the war period, there are numerous massacres that begin, especially in 1941. This rather dramatic art installation is on the Danube River. And it is a series of kind of like bronzed shoes that represent many Jews who were literally thrown into the Danube River by fascists to be drowned to death, sometimes tied together with one of them being shot so that they would save ammunition. It's a rather moving permanent installation there that that I had the distinct privilege of visiting when I was there most recently. The government, however, like many other East Central European governments who were allied with the Nazis, resisted the deportation of Jews who were Hungarian citizens. This is a rather interesting phenomenon that you see in several different parts of Nazi-allied countries, where Jews who are considered to be part of the country proper, although they are exposed to anti-Semitic legislation, they are nevertheless protected from the worst depredations of Nazism. This is not the case with migrant populations, refugee populations of Jews who find themselves inside the country. This changes in March of 1944 when the Nazis, who are clearly dissatisfied with the progress that Hungarians have made in enforcing Nazi demands on deportation of Jews, they finally take over the country in March of 1944 and they impose those restrictions themselves. Here you see the massive wave of deportations from Hungarian ghettos in 1944. This map is from the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, and it is at the very, very end of the war when you see the true evil of the Nazi regime, because they diverted so many of their valuable resources away from the war effort in order to try and capture as many Jews as possible and to swallow them up in the maw known as Auschwitz. Almost 500,000 Jews are ghettoized in April of 1944, and the deportations begin almost immediately thereafter. There are some remarkable efforts by outside parties to rescue Hungarian Jewry at this late date. The so-called Blut für Ware, or the Blood for Goods plan, in which the Nazis were literally bribed. The Jews were actually purchased in exchange for goods. Some 3,500 Jews were rescued in this manner, but it could not be scaled up in time to save a much larger population. In the end, when you look at the overall statistics, about 565,000 Hungarian Jews were murdered, or Jews who were in Hungary between 1940 and 1945. Then not all of them were Hungarian citizens, and about 260,000 were able to survive the war. But as I mentioned at the outset of this video, the Hungarian Jews showed remarkable resilience, particularly those in the diaspora. I was not able to confirm the veracity of this journalistic report that Brooklyn is the biggest Hungarian city outside Budapest, but you know what? It certainly could be. There is a really large and powerful and vibrant Hungarian Jewish community, particularly in Brooklyn, and it testifies to the strength of the Hungarian Jewish spirit. We know that by 1900, there are over 31,000 Hungarian-born immigrants in New York, and about 70% of those are Jewish. And just a decade later, there were 78 Hungarian Jewish self-help organizations, which really says a lot about what this community values and who they are and why they have become so strong today. So that's it for my very quick survey of Hungarian Jewry. There's obviously a lot more to say about the vibrancy of Jewish life in contemporary Hungary, and I hope to say more about that when I get there, God willing, later this year with the Ashkenazim project. But for the time being, I want to wish a Mazel Tov to the young couple and give them my blessing that they should be zocha to build a Bayis Neman B'Yisrael. And for everybody else, thank you very much for watching.